It's a very powerful mixture, you know.
Uh-huh.
So I just assumed I should refrigerate them, too.
Damn it, Towser, get on with your story. Stop giving me all these short sentences and making me go, like some kind of damn moron.
Uh-huh. I had to move one of the batches of candy canes to another part of the factory. I left a box next to a radiator in the lab.
And?
There's no more lab. The candy canes exploded. They react to extreme heat and turn volatile. We've got to stop this.
Stop? Are you insane?
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another exciting episode of Christmas Month. Last week, we, you know, rather enjoyed the Die Hard Home Alone R-rated take with Violent Night. It was a good way to start off our Christmas month. But unfortunately, there's a bad way that there's some bad angles we have to take when we go through this month. And this could be one of them. Mm. Now, I haven't seen this film literally since I was a kid back in 1985. This was a big budget for the time, $50 million, and this movie bombed at the box office.
$50 million for this?
Yeah, $50 million. Harrison Ford was linked to this.
Yeah, they wanted him to play the John Lithgow character, didn't they?
Yes, they wanted him to play Beezy. And it's like, thank God he read the script, or his agent fucking said no. They had John Carpenter linked with this.
That's right, the direct.
Yeah, he went on to do Big Trouble in Little China. Thank God.
Do you know why Carpenter ended up refusing?
He wanted the final say.
He also wanted to do the score, and the studio refused, so he parted ways with them, apparently.
Yeah, good on him.
Yep.
Everybody loves the John Carpenter stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Again, this was the studio that produced the Supermans and the Supergirls. So these guys didn't know how to run. They destroyed the Superman franchise. And, even the credits feel like Superman-ish. And
yeah, totally.
Even the way the sleigh flies, it's like Superman.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, even, you know, with the whole origin story, you know, that we'll get in the 1978.
Oh, my God.
The origin story on this one.
An hour long, the origin story. John Lithgow isn't in this until the movie's almost over.
Yeah.
He's the only thing in this film, and even that's cringeworthy.
Yes, it's pantomime villain.
Now, it's directed by a man called Jeanette Schwark. I apologize if I butchered that. Incredibly talented man. Has been directing TV shows since The Night Gallery back in the 70s, late 60s. And he's still directing big TV shows today. So good on him. He also directed, I actually think underrated, Jaws 2.
I like Jaws 2.
Yep. He directed Somewhere in Time. Very depressing film, but really good. And the one I just talked about, which I think I remember liking it. We might have to get to a whole Superman retrospective, but Supergirl.
Yes. I actually watched and reviewed that for my radio show recently. It's pretty bad, but it's kind of campy fun, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's kind of where they went with the Supermans after 1 and 2.
Yeah.
They went camp. Didn't work, because you can't go camp after giving us 1 and 2. You can't change the whole fucking genre on us.
Well, they did the same with the Burton Batman films as well.
Yeah, and that really worked out for them, didn't it?
But Supergirl, it's pretty awful, like, but it's kind of, there's something very legible about it. At the same time.
That's what I remember. I remember this cool carousel making people old or something. Yeah, I can't remember what it was.
And Helen Slater's quite legible.
Yeah, she is, yeah. I like Helen Slater.
Yes.
In the 80s, her and Leah Thompson. Mm-mm.
Yeah.
The Secret of My Success, that's my go-to for her.
Michael J. Fox was in that, didn't he?
Yeah. So this movie tanked.
I remember.
So there you have it. We talk about near the tail end of the 80s and in the beginning of the 90s. To me, Christmas movies peaked. I mentioned this a few times with the trifecta, which is Christmas Vacation, Scrooged, and Home Alone. And they haven't been back since. And they just pummel these Hallmark ones out now, which we'll be getting to soon.
Yeah, believe you me, we will be getting to those.
Yeah, because Trevor picked that one.
Did I? Fuck.
Well, did I? Fuck.
Yeah.
You did. You said, Ciaran, I need to talk to you about this amazing miracle.
Oh, I will be talking about it. Don't get me wrong. I will be talking about it, and it's going to be savage.
Here's the problem with Santa Claus. A, this is not for kids because it is extremely boring and
long.
It's an origin story. It's almost 2 hours long, and there's no really, I don't know where to go with. I'm shocked Dudley Moore's in this because Dudley Moore was hot off the Oscar race with Arthur.
Yeah.
Which is a wonderful film. Arthur is one of my favorites in the 80s. I love Dudley Moore in the 80s.
I like Dudley Moore generally anyway, but yeah.
Yeah, him and Peter Cook were always good together. And so, I John Lithgow, I give a pass on this one because John Lithgow, I like the fact that the man took chances. His career was started pretty much in the 80s, but he started like Terms of Endearment, a very likable character in that. And then he played a fucking vile assassin in Blowout. And then he'd do Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai, which is fucking balls to the wall nuts.
The Twilight Zone film as well.
The Twilight Zone film. He just did everything. He says, fuck, I'll take it, you know? And good on him. He finally, because that way an actor come, you know, trying to find his niche, can kind of dabble in everything to find out what works for him.
He was in the recent Pet Sematary remake as well.
Yeah, but, yeah, I mean, the guy's done hundreds of films.
Yeah, yeah, and but, TV shows, yeah.
But, you know, and John Lithgow gets a pass on that because he still does that. He still does, you know, zany quite well. Even in when he watched him as Dexter as a serial killer. Jesus, he's creepy. But he almost has that pantomime kind of character to him.
Yeah.
Despite the fact his ugliness and, you know, and what he's portraying.
Yeah, yeah.
I wish I was talking about John Lithgow, to be honest with you. Yeah, so the first part's an origin story. The second part is about a fucking dumbass elf named Patch,
yep,
who wants to work for a businessman in good faith to make toys so he can make toys to
candy
show Santa.
To fly.
Yeah, and to show Santa that he can do it on his own. Obviously, that backfires because obviously John Lithgow is the bad guy.
Yeah, it's basically because messes up, and a lot of the toys get returned because they're like broken by the parents or something.
How the fuck did Santa or anybody not catch that?
Well, exactly.
If there's an assembly line and things, they'd be falling apart right in front of the assembly line.
Yeah, yeah. Where's their quality control department? You know,
he's the quality. He was looking at everything.
Yeah,
and the wheels would be falling off already. Not tins. There's no screws going in. We see it. So the wheels would have fallen off at least in the bag.
Mrs. Claus at least should have caught it. You know.
Yeah. Dumb
hole. Santa himself was getting a bit tired. He was overworked. I think it's actually stated. So it is. But so Mrs. Claus, she was a bit more sort of clued in, and she should have caught it. You know, yeah. I mean, it's a bit of a slog. I remember this film at the time, but I don't think, you know, it was in video shops, and I believe it's obviously been on TV and stuff. And I think I've seen bits and pieces of it possibly on TV. But I've never actually sat down and watched it from start to finish until now.
Yeah, this thing was mass marketed.
Yeah,
it had product placement endorsements. They had
high
hopes
time
for this. It's in the film actually, and used poorly. We'll get to it. It's quite funny.
The kids are deeply annoying as well.
Yeah, I fucking hate that little bastard, Joe.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, chuck him off the fucking sleigh, little bastard.
It was like he was, even though it's like set in contemporary New York, it felt like it was like set in Victorian times or something.
Yeah, he was like Oliver.
Yeah, and I thought that could very possibly be intentional, you know, with Lithgow as basically Scrooge, so as well, you know, tying into the whole Dickens thing. But
Look at you. Look at you reading beyond the words.
What's that, sorry?
I'm sorry, I'm drinking my coffee. I have to wake up.
Right.
We're doing this for you fuckers at 9:30 in the morning. we're fucking doing this 9:30 in the morning so you assholes don't have to watch this shit. So you're welcome.
That's how committed we are to doing this public service. And here, the real fun's going to begin on the next one. with one of those Hallmark-esque films, and trust me, I'm going to fucking town on it. This is although it's not a very good film, it's, you know, it's not too, you know, hateful, if you know what I mean.
You know what, though? I think this is better than the Hallmark movie.
Oh, absolutely.
No, it isn't better, sorry.
It isn't better?
No.
I'd say it is.
This is too boring. At least the other one you could make fun of the whole time.
Well, that's a fair point. All right. But anyway.
So, we meet Saint Nick, but he's not Santa yet. He's traditionally an old dude with his wife. He dangerously brings her out in the blizzard.
Yeah, the stupid
blizzard
bastard.
Season.
Yeah.
Yeah, sadistic prick.
Yeah.
And brings little wooden toys to orphan kids. Now, if I was an orphan kid and I got a fucking shitty little wood carving, I'd be go fuck yourself, you piece of shit.
Hold on a minute. This is like some sort of small Scandinavian village. I mean, they didn't have anything. They didn't have iPads or anything back then. You know what I mean? Stop you behaving like a spoilt brat. These were very nice. A lot of current attention went into making these toys for these poor children back in the day. It was like 1400s
fuck
or something.
Off.
You know?
Fuck off.
Nobody joking. But yeah.
Yeah,
but no,
you would be the first one to go, fuck you.
No, I wasn't
my
a brat.
Devil's
I'm not a brat. I would have been very grateful at the current attention put into these, you know, beautiful little carvings.
You.
But
you'd be bitching because you didn't get your Ouija set or your Wicker Man doll or whatever the fuck you like, you freak.
But basically he kills, due to complete stupidity, he kills his wife and himself and his reindeers.
Yeah. I mean, the jolly old bastard really ended it. And they put reindeer frozen to death.
Yep.
Donner and Blitzen.
Yep.
Whatever the fuck their names are. And then, the North Star. Is that the North Star that glows?
I thought, yeah, apparently so. But it was like some sort of biblical sort of reference.
Okay, so it's Jesus.
Yeah, pretty
who makes
much, yeah.
Santa Claus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then they bring him to the land of the elves.
Yeah. It's pretty much the same set where where Superman's hideout is.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's 100% the vibes I got from it.
It's almost like they removed Christopher Reeve from and replaced him with the sleigh.
Yeah, 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 totally, yeah. And then Burgess Meredith pops up in a completely pointless cameo. Although it's
I fell asleep. I forgot about that part.
It's great. It's always great to see Burgess Meredith. Don't get me wrong. What I would say as well, there is a really strong supporting cast of sort of stalwart British actors here. You know,
oh, don't. No.
No, seriously, there's
no.
Melvin Hayes.
Don't say it.
No,
don't.
Melvin Hayes, who was like famous for It Ain't Half Hot Mum. Christopher Ryan, who was more famous for the likes of The Young Ones and Bottom, and also appeared in classic Doctor Who and the new series as a Santarin. Although he doesn't have any lines in this for some reason, but he has like loads of screen time. He's like the sort of stupid looking elf helper of Dudley Moore.
You got that right. The stupid looking one is the one in Doctor Who. That makes sense though.
I like Christopher Ryan very. You know, he's cute in The Young Ones and stuff. As
I'll say this, they casted well, like Dudley Moore and Burgess Meredith. They're tiny actors.
Yes.
So they did, you know.
So was Christopher Ryan and Melvin Hayes.
Again, nobody gives a shit about those two
people.
Well,
I do.
Nobody.
British people do. We'll know them from.
No, they don't.
Things
no,
like
they don't.
Only Fools and Horses.
People
half
right
hot
now, people in the UK aren't listening to this and going, oh, love, get me a cup of tea so we can watch another Christopher Ryan film.
Right. Was that an impression of a posh English person? Because.
That was good. That's
a day
just
job.
Like you.
You should have got a role in this as one of the elves.
Oh, fuck. 6'2", built like Chewbacca. Yeah, that would be great.
Or maybe Santa.
They'd probably chuck me into a reindeer suit. Fucking Prancer.
I could play the Lithgow character.
Yeah. Cruel bastard. Yeah, 40 minutes of dialogue of just boredom. I mean, what were they thinking?
It is a slog.
It is. Come on. No kid is sitting through this. Nothing happens. They don't even cut back and forth, really. It's just this story.
Kids these days, especially with like low concentration spans because of, you know, smartphones and the internet, would balk at this.
Yeah. No, this... I can't see this. This won't be a cult classic.
No, it's not.
I don't even see it played a lot. I think this is just buried and gone.
Yeah.
People will remember it. They go, oh, I think I remember that Dudley Moore thing.
Yeah.
But that's all it is. And if people put this on, they'll turn it off.
Did they make their money back? I mean, Abusehead bombed. Yeah.
At $50 million, it made 22.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
23 back. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why this company's not around. They're very arrogant. Didn't pay their actors.
Really?
Yeah. There's a great documentary. Richard Donner, who directed the late, great, great, great Richard Donner.
Yeah.
Was hired to do Superman 1 and 2. Mm-hmm. And that's why in Superman 1 and 2, they filmed sequences in sync.
Yes.
So you already knew Terrence Stamp and Sarah Douglas and Jack O'Halloran were playing the three baddies.
Yeah, General Zod and his gang.
Yeah, they filmed those scenes during Superman 1.
Yeah.
But he quit.
I know he did, yeah.
He had everything filmed for part 2. And he quit and wanted his name removed off it. So they hired Richard Lester.
Yeah.
Because the fucking idiots wanted more camp.
Right.
Oh. And Donner says, no, this is a dark tale.
Yeah.
These guys want revenge. He's challenging his life as being wanting to be human or not.
Yeah.
We're not going to boo doot doot doot. So all the tongue-in-cheek stuff, like when they go to the small bar town.
Yes.
So that was all Richard Lester. That's nothing against Richard Lester.
No, I know about the problems Donner had, you know, with Superman 2.
Now the 4K copy has both versions.
The Donner cut, yeah.
Yeah, there's the Donner cut, and then there's Richard Lester cut. Yeah. And again, nothing against Richard Lester. I grew up with the Richard Lester cut. Didn't know about this until the Donner cut came out.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to take it more seriously, you stick with the Donner cut. If you like your camp, you go with the Richard Lester cut.
And then they went with Richard Pryor and Nuclear Man. And
like, you know that scene in where Superman takes the big S on his chest and he throws it at?
Yes.
That's not in there.
Right.
Because they thought that was stupid. So Richard Donner just scraped everything Richard Lester did.
Yeah, yeah.
Again, that was because Richard Lester was just buying what the fucking producers wanted.
Yes.
They didn't pay Christopher Reeve. Who did they? No, Gene Hackman never got paid, I think it was.
Huh?
So he wouldn't come back. That's why he didn't come back.
Yeah. Bastards, yeah.
Yeah, they were just cutting corners everywhere.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they've fallen on their own sword, especially with this bombing, so, yeah.
Who was? Oh, my God. You know, I'm tearing these guys to shreds, but I should really back up who they are. Superman. 78. It's Scotland or something like that?
Yeah.
Producers. I can't get the Superman theme out of my head. It's really sad we're talking about this and not the piece of shit we're talking
about. Well,
there's
not much to talk about, to be fair, with Santa Claus the movie, because it's, about the halfway mark, where then Dudley Moore then comes into it more. And makes like a magic.
I love how you're continuing it.
Yeah,
I'll finish this up.
I'm trying to fill in the gaps here. You know.
No, I've got some stuff to talk about. We're cool. Not much, but
yeah.
I'm just looking it up. Come on. Oh, there it is. Got it. Okay. There's the man himself, Richard Donner.
Donner started off directing episodes of The Twilight Zone as well.
Yeah, well, his fucking kickoff start was the classic, The Omen.
Yeah.
So you can't go wrong with that. All right, so the guys who are involved, fucking hell.
Yeah, anytime this fucking millennium, take your time. You know?
It's Sulkin, the Sulkin brothers.
Right.
I believe they are. It's Alexander and Aya Sulkin. And they bankrupt their own company.
Yeah.
Because they overspent, didn't know really what they were doing. They hit it out of the park with Superman and Superman 2. They got lucky. And then from there, everything just fell flat. They took chances on movies like this.
Yes.
And I think Supergirl was the one that finally ended their reign.
Mm-hmm.
But they have to jump back into this piece of shit. Oh. So he Pash wants to be head toy guy.
Yes.
And he creates this assembly line and don't know how he doesn't catch, like we talked about, how he doesn't catch
the broken toys that don't work.
Broken toys and how they're staying together when nothing's being nailed or screwed in.
Yeah, it's stupid. Magic.
It's fucking
or something.
It's careless. It's careless filmmaking. Something should have happened where the glue wouldn't stick properly and it's going to eventually fall apart.
Or it was sabotaged or something by the other elf who was actually evil, you know, who was like Dudley Moore's rival who wanted the job, you know?
Yeah. Something where this would, you know, yeah.
It made sense.
He's got to redeem himself.
Yeah.
But that doesn't happen. So he's going to fucking quit.
Mm-hmm.
And then we meet Joe, this little fucker, this little homeless prick.
Yeah.
I love the blatant product ad. Usually you go, hey, Trevor, what are you doing? Not much. I'm going to McDonald's to get myself a Big Mac.
I know. That's ridiculous.
That's product placement, right, guys?
Yeah.
Oh. This one is people eating stuff in their faces in a McDonald's while the poor fucking homeless kid's staring through the window.
It's literally rubbing it in. Yeah.
It's a horrible product placement.
Yeah. Yeah. I know. Because, you know, there are actual homeless kids who, you know, who I don't know, that could actually happen to. It's pretty obscene.
It's just not a good fit for this.
No. You know what? It's also not a good look for McDonald's, who they're doing the product placement
with. Yeah, that's my point. And then he's stalking this little girl.
Yeah, she's posh.
Yeah, Cornelia, who's we find out. I love how, oh my God, her uncle is BZ.
Yes.
No way.
Yeah, there's
a
shocker.
There's a big picture of him. There's a big picture of him on the fireplace.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm going to assume that's his niece.
She's pretty awful, like, you know.
Oh, yeah. That hair. Fuck that hair.
Yeah, yeah.
She looks like a Lego kid. But, so she sneaks Joe a Christmas dinner.
Mm-hmm.
And gives him this big plate. And then sets down, here's a Coke.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it reminded me of the blatant product placement. It reminded me of, you know, in Wayne's World, where he takes a piss out of that type of thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's pretty much, the Wayne's World scene is pretty much a parody of this.
So, Santa's flying around at this point, and he sees the stupid kid.
Yeah.
And he gives him a lift.
Yeah.
Then he shows him all this glorious magic that he has. Then he chucks him back on the fucking roof.
Yeah.
And goes, all right, see you next year.
Yeah. And also,
yeah, if I survive.
Yeah, and also, you better fucking behave yourself because I only give fucking presents to good kids. And they fuck off, you know, basically.
Yeah. And then he's seen carving a fucking wooden figure that happens to look like Patch.
Yes.
And he goes, I'm going to give this to Joe next year.
What use is
that
to Joe?
What the fuck is a homeless kid who needs food going to do with a wooden figure?
Exactly. Why didn't he just like give him a fucking house and, you know, maybe some food and, like, I don't know, a warm coat or something? Instead, he gives him a fucking wooden toy.
Well, he could chuck it in the fire so he can maybe
keep himself warm.
Evening.
Yeah. Instead, he gives him a fucking stupid carving that looks like fucking Dudley Moore.
Fucking hell. I'll be like, why the fuck you give me this picture of Arthur?
Yeah, yeah. Here's another thing. I'm jumping ahead a bit, but the finale isn't even set at Christmas. It's set after Christmas in January. What the fuck?
Well, yeah, but it's because they have to conclude because...
Christmas 2 they're having or something?
It's Christmas 2?
Yeah.
Because, so let me get this right. John Lithgow gives away these free lolly candy canes.
Yes.
And he's making a mint off him.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
And then we find out that the secret ingredient that Dudley Moore uses will blow up.
Yes. It's basically
kept
dynamite
in a warm
or something.
Place.
Yeah.
And they're him and Towser, who by the way was in Jaws movies,
mm-hmm.
Is going to go live somewhere where there's no extradition, and they're gonna run away with millions.
Yeah,
and they're gonna let Patch take the rap for it.
They're gonna basically fuck off to him and his assistant to Brazil, actually, to say, because they talk about, you know, like having drinks in the beach and, you know, bikini clad sort of assistants and stuff, you know, girls, you know, looking after them, that type of thing. And they're going to blame it on Dudley Moore, Patch or Batch or whatever you call him, and I don't know. That's
Patch.
Yeah.
Get it right, man.
That's pretty much the plot.
Fucking stupid.
Yeah.
Fucking stupid. What a waste.
And it tries to be a sort of, you know, a sort of commentary on sort of capitalism and, you know, that type of thing. But,
you know what, though? This is a fucking kids film. You don't need it.
Yeah, but, well, not only that, they don't pull it off, more importantly, because it's just so, you know, especially Lithgow's performance, it's just so over-the-top ridiculous. It doesn't work.
So, Patch is pretty much a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he's stupid.
Yes.
Let's get that out of the way.
Well, he's more like naive and sort of silly and innocent type thing.
He's an idiot.
Yeah.
He's
a good heart, but...
He's an idiot. Fuck, if I was Santa, I'd
sack him?
Yeah, I'd be like, come here. Yeah. You almost killed all these kids.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know. Well,
to be fair...
You know what they should have done? Like a director's cut?
Yeah.
And maybe get Richard Donner to come in. And,
or John Carpenter?
Yeah, get him in and feed Patch to a polar bear slowly.
Well, not only that, he almost kills a lot of kids twice. First, with the shitty toys that fall apart, you know, like the bikes and stuff that fall apart. I mean, one of them actually literally gets run over by a bus, which could easily have had the kid on it.
That would have been awesome. That's John Carpenter.
Yeah, exactly. And then the second time with the exploding, flying candy cane sticks nonsense.
How the hell? I might have missed this because I probably fell asleep. What? Who's going to buy something that makes you float?
Well, I mean, kids want to fly. It would be a very popular toy, I would imagine. I mean, I would like
what
that
parent,
if it was real.
What parent is going to allow their kid to eat something that makes them fly away?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it'd be a pretty cool present, and it'd be pretty popular, to be fair. But
if they have no idea how to control it or what they're doing.
Yeah, I was just about to say, it's also extremely dangerous.
Fucking hell.
Yeah.
Yeah, because at the end, John Lithgow needs to escape, so he starts eating all these candy canes.
Yeah, it goes to space.
Because the police are coming. Yeah, and he jumps out the window, but he's eating too much, and he floats away in space.
Yeah.
Which, wouldn't he, like, die?
I was just about to say, his body should have burnt up whenever, you know, going through the atmosphere of the Earth. And also, he's screaming and stuff, and you can't actually, there's no atmosphere in space. It doesn't make any sense whatsoever, scientifically. I get that it's a silly kids film. And, you know, it you can sort of get away with stuff like that, but it did irk me because I'm a bit of I'm pedantic with stuff like that. He wouldn't have, in space, you know, as the tagline goes, in space no one can hear you scream. You can't even scream in space, but he can.
So, I mean, and at the end,
his body should have burnt up when going through the Earth's atmosphere.
So he can't, he ends up kidnapping Joan Cornelia for himself.
Yes.
Santa.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Because Cornelia now lost her stepfather, well, her uncle.
Yes.
And Joe's obviously a homeless twat.
Yes, not for anybody.
Yeah, he's a loser.
Yep.
And they end up because they end up teaming up and saving the day,
and going on living in magical Santa Land.
Yeah.
And Mike from the Young Ones is there, and Melvin Hayes stuff. You know.
Oh, whatever, guys. Some people know, never heard of. Yeah, this is just terrible.
I can see sort of some kids in the 80s liking it.
Oh, fuck me. Here we go.
I wouldn't even have liked this as a kid. It's just, I don't like kids' films. Never have done, even when I was a kid. But yeah, this is pretty, it's a tough watch in that it's boring.
Yeah, it's a piece of shit.
Yeah. Yeah,
I have nothing else to say. I mean, it's cheap effect. Well, I'm not going to blame the effects for the time. I'll go with it, but it's
the script's a mess as well from a more technical level.
And the sad thing is, casting was okay.
Yeah, no, it's
casting. Yeah, a decent cast. Yes. Mm-hmm. You know, you could have made this work.
The script's all over the place.
$50 million, and you couldn't write something that's
yeah.
This is just two ego producers. I talked about it that. Yeah, that's all. Just two ego producers.
It feels like two different types of films fused together. The whole sort of more serious fantasy elements, you know, that we get with the first hour, the origin story stuff, and then we'll go into wacky comedy set in the present day. which, so there's, you know, plus there's the sort of Dickensian stuff going on as well. So it's a bit of a mishmash of a lot of things, and they don't pull off any of them.
They should have. What they should have done is cut back and forth.
Yeah.
Give Lyca more screen time and show him, and you're going up this mountain on the left side of him, and you got the right side of the mountain, you got the Santa tail, and have it going up and up and up and up, and then the spike hits, they get to the top of the peak.
Yeah, they get together.
And their worlds collide.
Yeah.
That's what should have happened here.
Yeah.
Not an hour of fucking Santa and Mrs. Claus petting, chucking each other off. I don't need this shit. Fuck me.
I mean.
Or even give us fun elements at least then. If you're going to give us a Santa world for an hour, give us Rudolph. Give us Frosty the Snowman.
Yeah.
Give us cool characters that we remember as a kid. Give us somebody we can go, oh, not some fucking stupid man in a fucking...
Even Santa's pretty forgettable in this himself, who's like the title character. The only,
good actor,
the only memorable character
of
this guy's annoying as well as this. It's over-the-top pantomime nonsense. I have to, you know, being honest. The only memorable character here for me is Dudley Moore.
I'd probably go Lithgow, just because he's so bad it's good kind of vibe. Yeah. He plays that well. But yeah, guys, avoid this at all costs. Christmas movies, like we mentioned, are hit or miss. We'll dive more into it when we talk about the Hallmark ones next up. But yeah, it is what it is. Destined to fail. There was no way this was going to be a hit, especially with the troublesome producers at the helm. And that's all I have for this one. And do you want to add anything else?
No.
Okay, there
I'm
you
done.
Go. All right, guys, we're going to wrap this one up. Coming up is the one that Trevor has been dying to get on the air, A Castle for Christmas. It's not a Hallmark one, but it's in the same vein. We'll get more into details, and you won't believe who directed it.
I do.
I am shocked
yes.
who directed this next film we're about to talk about. Mm-hmm. Until then, if you guys want to reach out to us, you can grab us at CitizenFrame_podcast and, of course, Facebook. And that's all I have for you today. We're going to end this one. Talk to you soon.